In last few lectures, we have been seeing the instability in rotor system. Today, we will take up another kind of instability, which is called steam valve, and we will see how also the seals can give instability into this. So, basically, this steam valves will find that will be present when the turbine is having very high pressure. So, is mainly occurs in the high pressure turbines, and basically it limits the how much we can able to generate the power in a particular turbine. So, the steam valve generally limits the how much maximum power we can able to generate in a turbine. So, with a very simple model, we will try to study the steam valve and also how the seals can able to introduce the instability into the rotor system. Before that, we will introduce these seals, various type of seals used in the rotor between the rotating part and the stationary part, and then we will with the simple model try to see how this can stabilize the rotor system. So, basically in this we will be dealing with the instability in rotor due to steam valve and due to the seals. And basic concepts we will introduce of these two terminology. So, let us see the dynamic seal. So, in rotors we will find various kind of seals, like this is a rotor which is rotating about its own axis. This is the either this is stator, and basically this is seal which is provided generally to stop or to minimize the flow of the working fluid or the lubricant from one end of the shaft to another one. So, here simple cylindrical shape is there of the seal. Generally, the seals are having larger clearance as compared to the bearing. So, in this hydrodynamic action is not present, and this is another kind of seals in which this the path is tapered so that the flow of the lubricant from one end to another end is less. There are some other kind of seals like the stepped seal. So, instead of the single straight cylindrical or the tapered, there is this stepped annular seals are there. Apart from this, there are different variations of the seals, like this the labyrinth seal in this particular case the teeth is on the stator. So, this is the stator and teeth is on the stator, and basically they will prevent the flow of the lubricant, and because of this obstruction the flow of the lubricant will be less. And similarly, we can have the labyrinth seal on the rotor instead of the stator, and basically they are all over the circumference, and we see that this prevents the leakage of the fluid because of the various obstructions. Sometimes this labyrinth seals are provided in not only in the stator but also in the rotor, so that the path of the working fluid or lubricant is zigzag when it is passing through the seals. So, with this prevention of the working fluid is more and better in sealing can be done, dynamic sealing can be done with such arrangement. Apart from this, in the turbine blades sometimes like this the impeller in which the fluid can come from this side. So, to prevent the leakage of the fluid from coming from this side, some kind of seals are provided so that the leakage is minimized in this particular case. So, fluid is coming like this and we want to prevent the leakage through this, because this is a rotor and this is the stator. So, there has to be some clearance between them, and we do not want the lubricant to flow in this direction. So, this prevents the leakage of the fluid. This is another think you can see this is the rotor tip, and the fluid may pass through the gap between the rotor tip and the stator. And to prevent this, some kind of slots are provided at the tip of the rotor. So you can able to see the slots, and is similar to the labyrinth seal, and it prevents the leakage of the fluid from the tip clearance. And this is generally required so that the leakage, the steam or working fluid should not take place at the tip, because that will be loss, because it has to pass through the blades. And this is the, if we see from the top, this slot cross section is like this. So you can able to see there are vanes also at the top. So classical tip slots design, which gives better stability of the system. So basically, the seals and this slots, they provide some kind of instability, and we'll try to study in the present lecture this kind of instability. So with this small introduction to the especially seals, dynamic seals and the shrouds, now we'll try to see how we can able to understand the steam fault in the rotor system. So basically, the steam excited valve of high pressure turbine rotors is caused by blade tip shrouds and shaft labyrinth seal forces, and by steam flow forces on the blades. And the seal valve forces is destabilizing for some condition and stabilizing for other conditions. The problem of steam valve is one of the technological limit that now prohibit the development of power generating turbo machinery substantially below 1 gigawatts. So, due to steam flow, self excited vibration developed at high load in the form of stable limit cycle that at even higher loads deteriorates the chaotic vibration of the of high amplitudes. So, let us see the equation of motion of a Jeffcott rotor, and in which the steam valve is taking place. So, for that this kind of equation of motion is valid. So, you can able to see the first three term is belonging to the rotor, but this is due to the steam valve. So, basically steam valve stiffness is coupling the y direction equation of motion with the x direction equation of motion. And if you see the y direction equation of motion, here the stiffness is negative. So, that means you can able to see, because of the steam fault, we are getting the cross coupling. Also, the stiffness matrix become asymmetric, it becomes skew symmetric. So, basically if we put the stiffness matrix in the form of matrix, we will find is a skew symmetric stiffness matrix like this. And it should be noted that the steam valve force gives the cross coupled restraining force, and the stiffness matrix becomes skew symmetric. Now we'll try to solve this equation by in the form of complex displacement, which we have defined as x plus j y. So with this, we'll multiply the second equation by j and add it to the first equation. So, you can able to see that the first term will be simple, m s double dot plus c s dot. So, this is the first two terms will give this, and then this k x and k, this k x and k y will give us this, then k s w, that is for steam valve, x plus minus k s w j y is equal to 0. So, if we multiply this by j and this by, so basically we will get equation of this form. This is x, and now these two quantity we can able to see, this SW is common. So basically we can able to write this also as plus, and then this will be cubic, and here we have plus 1, so we can able to write this. So if we remove the cubic term, then we will get jy plus x, and which is nothing but s. So this will give us this quantity, this will be minus j k s w s. So basically we can able to get the equation of motion in the complex domain in stationary coordinate system like this. So this is the equation of motion which we derived. Now we are assuming the solution of this as amplitude and some frequency component or eigenvalue component, and if we differentiate this we will get this quantity. If we substitute this in the equation of motion, we will get s lambda t plus c lambda s lambda t, and then this will be as it is. And now you can able to see s lambda t is common, so that will go out and we will left with this equation. So basically this is the frequency equation, this is a frequency equation. Now we are simplifying this equation. Basically if you see this previous equation is in terms of m, c and k, so if we divide whole expression by m, so we will get this as c by m and k by m and this by m, and now we can able to simplify by defining natural frequency square as k by m, and this omega square sw steam hold, this is parameter we are defining by this, and this is the damping ratio, and critical damping is defined like this. So if we use this non-dimensional parameters, we can able to write the previous equation in this form. Now this is a quadratic equation in terms of lambda, so we can able to solve for lambda, so we will get two roots from this. So simplified form of that, because this is a quadratic equation, that we can able to get in a closed form solution. So this is the quadratic equation solution, and we have two roots of this lambda, and the form of this is like this, in which we have alpha I as a real part and beta I is imaginary part, where I can be 1 to 2, and this alpha I will see that this is a real part, some quantity of the real part may come from the term within the square bracket also, and the remaining part will be the imaginary part which will come from this square bracket, sum of the parts. So now we should note that some of the real parts may come from the terms within the square bracket of the equation, as it will be clear in the following case at the boundary of stability. So here we will be defining a boundary of stability. Basically in the previous eigenvalue solution, the system is unstable when the real part of lambda is positive, and it is stable when real part is negative. And as the boundary of stability will be when this real part lambda is 0. So in one case when it is positive, we have an unstable region. If it is negative, we have stable region. So in between this, when this lambda is 0, we will be having that will be the boundary of stability. Hence let us defining the eigenvalue at the instability, at the stability boundary as pure imaginary. Let us say the real part is purely 0. So this is the we are assuming that this lambda is j nu, where nu is the some frequency and there is no real part in this. So this is the condition of boundary of stability. So this was the equation, frequency equation. If we substitute in this lambda is equal to g nu, that is the boundary of instability condition, we will get this equation. So you can able to see this will become minus nu square, and other places we can replace lambda by j nu, so we will get this expression. So in this we can able to separate the real part and imaginary part. So if we separate the real part into sides, we will get this, and for imaginary part we will get this. From this we can able to see that nu is equal to omega nf, which is defined as k by m. So this is the basically the frequency will be at the boundary of instability, this frequency will be equal to the natural frequency of the system. And this is obvious also, because when the real part is 0, that means there is no damping in the system. So frequency of oscillation will be undamped natural frequency. And from the second equation, this second equation of the imaginary part, we will get this condition, which we can able to write like this. If we express this in terms of k and m, and this will be k s w by m, and this will be k by m. Now the roots which we obtained earlier, so in that this was the roots in which we had a real part and imaginary part, but now we are substituting the condition of boundary of stability in this. So that, so here we are substituting condition of boundary of instability, that means this condition. So if we substitute this here, we will get this, and if we simplify this, finally we will get this expression. So you can able to see, when we have positive quantity here, then this two parts are cancelling each other and the real part is 0. So that was the condition of instability, but when we are taking the negative, then the real part is imaginary, that is giving a stable solution. So one of the root gives the boundary of instability, and another is giving the stable solution for this. Now it should be noted that the real part is 0 for the positive sign, and negative sign the real part is negative, which is the case of the boundary of instability that we already discussed. The stability condition can be obtained as follows by Routh-Hurwitz stability criteria. This particular criteria which we described earlier was for a real polynomial, but now the present polynomial which is of this form is having some complex coefficient. So more general form of the complex coefficient for a polynomial, quadratic polynomial, could be like this, where these are the coefficients. So if we compare these two, we can able to get various coefficients, like a naught will be 1, there is no imaginary part here, so b naught will be 0. Like that we can able to compare these two polynomial, and we can able to get a naught, b naught, a 1, b 1, a 2, b 2, and the condition of stability is the first condition is this one. Determinant of this should be 0, here minus is there. Similarly, determinant of this quantity should be greater than 0, so for stability of the system. In this particular case, this previously we used it when we previously we used in the previous lectures, but the difference of this polynomial and in this is, you can able to see there is a, this is a lambda naught and this is a lambda. So basically lambda and lambda naught is defined like this, because earlier the solution was something like this, and now we have chosen the solution like this. So we have the difference of j here, so that means if we substitute lambda is equal to j lambda naught, then these two polynomial will be equivalent. So if we substitute that, we will get this expression, and basically now we have converted the present polynomial in the form of solution of this form, and now we can able to compare these two polynomial, this polynomial and the general form of this, to get the coefficients a naught, b naught, etcetera. So from first condition, this determinant, if we are equating 0, we are getting this condition. From second one, after simplification, we will get this condition that k s w by k should be less than 2 zeta, which is damping ratio. So it can be seen from above equation that instability due to steam hold can be avoided by sufficiently high damping. If damping is high, then this condition is we can able to satisfy, and if k is the natural frequency is more, that means this is more, then we can able to have better stability in the system. The present model, we considered only the this steam hold stiffness, but in actual case, apart from this, we'll be having the damping and stiffness from the bearings, and that also we need to consider while analyzing the steam hold, and for that case we'll be having the conditions slightly more complicated, but this is the basic premise regarding the steam hold, and this particular case we'll see in the subsequent thing, in which we'll be considering the seals as the system in the system along with the bearing. So in the last we have seen that how we can able to analyze a steam hold, and how we can able to get the condition of the steam hold, and how we can able to improve the stability of the rotor system with the steam hold. Now we'll take up a case of a seal along with the bearing in a rotor system, and in this particular case we'll try to get the condition, but we'll see that the expressions will be more complicated to analyze as a general, but for a very specific cases we can able to analyze that particular system. So that means we will take this kind of rotor system. We are considering only the translational motion, and these are the bearings, and they are symmetric, and seals are also symmetric. And for equation of motion for this system, we can have like this. So in this, basically, this is the mass coefficient of the seal. So seal direct coefficients of the mass. These are the damping coefficients of the seal, direct one, and these are the cross coupled one. Cross coupled, you can able to see this Q symmetric is there. Similarly, this SD, this is seal direct coefficient of the stiffness, and this is the cross coupled seal coefficients. Now other parameter like M, C and K, they are coming from rotor and the bearing. Bearing in this particular case, we have taken simple direct stiffness or direct damping and direct stiffness. We are not considered cross coupled stiffness and damping. Only these couplings are there in the seals or damping and the seal stiffness, because we want to analyze this particular seal parameter in more specific case. These parameter of the seals will be there generally when the speed of the rotor is very high, otherwise these parameters can be ignored. So those two equations which we had in the matrix form, we can able to write in a complex displacement S by defining S is equal to x plus g y. So if we multiply the first the second equation by j and add it to first one, we will get equation of motion like this. So we already seen how to take care of some terms which are having y plus jx kind of term. So we will get complex coefficients for such cases. So this is the equation of motion for that case. Now this we can able to simplify, and all the terms we can able to write in the terms of s. So this is the equation of motion for that. Now we are choosing the solution of this, like s e j nu t. So in this particular case, if we take the derivative, we will get this, and this we can able to substitute in the equation of motion to get the frequency equation like this. And this frequency equation is similar quadratic polynomial with the coefficients as complex. So the previous stability conditions in terms of a naught, b naught, that we can able to apply here out Hurwitz criteria. So this is the first condition. So this gives this condition. Second condition was 4 by 4 matrix. So if we simplify this, we will get an equation like this. So in this you can able to see so many parameters are there. So it's not easy to interpret which parameter will govern what, but this is the general expression, and if we have the values of this, we can able to see the stability of the system clearly. So for a special case, like if we substitute the mass coefficients of the seals and also of the damping coefficient, and this is equal to 0, then equation of motion and condition of stability reduces to the case of the steam hold. So similar to the steam hold case will be there if we take in the this particular example this coefficients as 0. So you can able to see that this particular conditions are more general, and very special cases we can able to analyze by putting these parameter one by one or in combination equal to 0. Now we will take up another case in which generally we need to accelerate the rotor at a certain angular acceleration, basically to avoid the critical speed or to avoid the instability zones. We need to accelerate the rotor at a particular rate so that we don't give much time to the rotor to be there near the critical speed or within the instability zone. And if we cross these zones quickly, then the possibility that rotor gets very high amplitude will be very less. In this particular case, we will be considering two cases. One is we will be having constant torque, so the supply is unlimited, supply is having limited power, so the constant torque it can apply. The second case is the constant acceleration, especially the angular acceleration. In that, depending upon the requirement, the whatever the drive is there, it can change its torque and it can give a required torque. So in this particular case, we have unlimited power source. So this kind of practical difficulty we may have in the real system. So let us try to analyze these two cases. And in this, basically the equation of motions will find that in especially when we are considering that we are giving a constant torque, the equation of motion will be nonlinear in nature. And in this particular case, we will be solving this using some kind of direct numerical integration in time domain, and we will get the response of the system with time by these numerical techniques. So basically in this particular case, we will be having nonlinear equation of motion of Jeppcott rotor. For run up or run down of the rotor, as we have already mentioned, so in real case quite often it is required to accelerate the rotor from rest to its operating speed with certain angular acceleration. It is required while run up or start up to cross critical speed or instability regions quickly. so that the time taken in traversing these critical speeds or instability regions are short to avoid possible buildup of the large oscillations. The following example of the equation of motion of Jacob rotor will be derived and analyzed for a variable speed of the rotor. So, in this particular case, because angular acceleration is there, so the speed of the rotor will be variable. So, this is a problem in which we will be, through this example, we will be basically explaining this particular run up case. So, we have in this three generalized coordinate x, y, z, x, y and theta of the rotor. X, y and y are the transverse displacement which of the geometrical center of the rotor, and theta is the angular position of the eccentricity with reference to one of the axis, which is x axis. So, basically theta is the torsional displacement and x and y are the transverse displacement. And so, in this first we will be obtaining the equation of motion in this x, y and theta direction, and then and especially in this we will not be considering the speed as constant, but it is variable, and this will be variable because there is external torque in the rotor system. And in the second case we will be analyzing for ideally balanced rotor, this what will be the basically time required to reach the angular velocity, whatever the maximum velocity from rest, how much it time it takes to reach up to that point. In this particular case we will assume the torque as constant. And another case, when the eccentricity is present in the system, we will be obtaining the unbalanced response for known constant angular acceleration with some zero initial condition. That means we will be having angular acceleration conditions like this, even the angular velocity, and this is the angular displacement. So, you can able to see the angular displacement is changing with time, square of the time. In this particular case, as I mentioned earlier, constant torque, that is a limited power source. And another case is the known angular acceleration. In this, the power source is having unlimited power. So, first let us try to derive the equation of motion. So, basically the rotor is like this, x, y and z is in this direction and is rotating with in counterclockwise direction, which is theta direction. This is theta velocity. Now, if we take the free body diagram of this, we will see that these are the elastic force from the shaft. This is gravity force. In this particular case, this the static equilibrium is at the bearing center and there will be some static deformation. So, to take care of that, the weight we need to consider here, especially in the nonlinear system, we need to consider this because we cannot able to shift this the coordinate axis to the static equilibrium position because of the nonlinearity in the system. For linear system generally we shift it. So, this will act, and we have this x, y as stationary coordinate system, and this is another coordinate system xi and eta is a rotating coordinate system which we have encountered in the previous lectures also. So, with this we can able to write the equation of motion. So, we can able to see apart from the stiffness, we can able to add the damping force also. So, this is the external force should be equal to the mass into angular acceleration, and this is the angular position, this is the linear position of the center of gravity of the rotor. So, so this is x and e, this is the eccentricity e, this is the center of gravity, so e cos theta. So, x plus e cos theta will be the location of the center of gravity. Similarly, in the y direction, y plus e sin theta plus weight also we are considering here, because positive y direction is in the upward direction. So basically this should have been this side as minus, and then these are the external forces equal to the inertia, mass into angular mass into the linear acceleration. And the third one is the torque, so torque balance. So in this you can able to see, in if you are taking moment about this, so we will be having k x into e sin theta, k x into e sin theta, that is the moment, and that is acting opposite to the rotation direction, that will be negative. From this we will be having k y e cos theta, but this is positive, and torque let us say is acting in the positive direction, so t, so this is t torque t. So these are the, and from damping also similar terms will come. So you can able to see torque, stiffness and damping should be equal to polar moment of inertia, mass moment of inertia into angular acceleration. So these are the three equation of motion in x direction, y direction and theta direction. Basically they are coupled theta, and these equations we can able to write like this. So these are the three equations which we derived in x, y and theta direction. You can able to see theta are appearing in these two equations, and so if you want to solve this we need to solve simultaneously, and in this particular case if we see there is a non-linear terms of the theta also, because square of the velocities and sin theta cos theta, they are also non-linear term. So basically these are non-linear coupled equation, but for special cases we can able to decouple them. So we will see that how we can able to decouple. So for known torque, so if we know the torque how much we are applying, the equation, all three equations we need to solve simultaneously, because if we know the torque then we cannot able to uncouple these. In another case, if we have required angular acceleration, so instead of we know the torque, if we have required angular acceleration, these are known, then the equation d and e will be uncoupled, and we can able to solve for x and y independent of each other. And once we solve x and y, we can able to come to this equation to get what should be the torque required to give that particular kind of angular acceleration or angular velocity. So in this particular case, the second case in which the angular acceleration and velocity are specified, these two equations are uncoupled, and we can able to solve this to get the torque, the third equation. So in this particular case the simultaneous solution of this is not required. So now let us take the case when the rotor is perfectly balanced, the eccentricity is 0, that means all the terms in the equation of motion in the right hand side are 0, and we have constant torque. So in if we have constant torque, then we can able to see that the last equation all the terms will be 0, only this inertia, rotor inertia and the torque will be present, which is constant. So this we can able to rearrange like this, I p into d theta dot and t into dt, and we can integrate this from 0 to what is the maximum angular velocity we required, and what is the time from 0 to t max, what is the time required to reach that particular speed. So if we integrate it, basically we can able to get the time required to reach omega max. So this will be the expression for that. This is valid for the constant torque and when there is no eccentricity of the rotor. The next is, now for known constant acceleration with these initial conditions, let us say these are given to us, these are specified, then the unbalanced rotor equation of motion which we had written earlier will take this form. So now you can able to see in place of theta double dot theta we wrote this, and theta dot we wrote this, and now these equations are independent. We can able to solve this equation and this equation independent of each other, like this. Now, and so basically here now we'll be obtaining this, because here the forcing is general in nature, because this is the external force. Because of angular acceleration, the force is not linear, is varying continuously with time. So we will be using some kind of time integrated integration method, numerical method, like Newton or Neumark's method. We can able to use it. Before using it, we are non-dimensionalizing the previous equation, like dimensionless displacement, x by eccentricity. So we are solving one of the equation in the x direction. Y direction displacement will be similar to this one. Then non-dimensional time, frequency into time, non-dimensional acceleration we are defining like this. This is the natural frequency, undamped one. This is the damping ratio. So these non-dimensional terms we can introduce in various terms of the equation of motion, like mx double dot. This can be written like this, and in turn we can able to define non-dimensional or displacement and the time. So basically mx double dot can be written like this. Similarly, cx dot we can able to write in the terms of non-dimensional term like this. Kx can be written like this. Then some other terms, like this is coming into the mass term. So equation of motion, we are dividing the whole equation of motion by this. So that means in the damping term, this divided by this, which is these two terms, again we can able to write in the non-dimensional term. Similarly, in the stiffness term, this divided by this will come unity. So like that we will introduce the various non-dimensional terms. Similarly, in the forcing term, this division is there, because we have divided this throughout the equation of motion. So this equation we can able to, in several steps, finally we will get a simple equation like this for the forcing term. So basically, equation of motion in the non-dimensional form will be of this form, where f t is given by this, where theta itself is defined like this. So basically, now equation is ready for numerical simulation. And in this equation of motion, we can able to see there are only two parameters now. One is the damping ratio, and another is the non-dimensional angular acceleration. So one is damping ratio, and another is the non-dimensional angular acceleration. We can able to study the effect of these parameter on the response. So now we will be obtaining plot of the response with non-dimensional time. So as we had two parameter to play with, so we can able to take different cases. So these two cases we have simulated, in which damping ratio was, and this angular acceleration non-dimensional was chosen, and we have obtained the various responses. So this is a typical non-dimensional displacement x prime with non-dimensional time. So we can able to see with time how the response changes. This is for one particular case. In this particular case, this behavior is there because there is a angular acceleration of the rotor. This is the transient velocity in place of displacement. Velocity is there. This is the basically plot of the x and the x dot, x prime and x prime dot. So this is a phase plot, transient phase plot. So when resonance is approaching, you can able to see that gradually the amplitudes are increasing, and once we cross the resonance, this is a terminating resonance, so it is coming down. This is the steady state response with time for particular frequency. So at one particular frequency, if we are not having acceleration, this will be the form of the response. And for that particular steady state response, obviously this is the frequency domain data, so the peak will be there corresponding to that particular frequency. This is the overlap, the transient and the steady state response with frequency. So you can able to see this is in the semi log case. So this is the case with without transient, and with acceleration, angular acceleration, we overlap these two responses in one for comparison purpose. And this is the non-stationary response with angular speed. So how the amplitude x is changing, x dot is x prime is changing with angular speed. So you can able to see this is the resonance. After that, there is a this kind of non-transient behavior. This is for the another case. Similar plots are there for different damping and angular acceleration. So these are, this for velocity, this is for approaching resonance, this is for terminating resonance, this is steady state. Just for comparison, we have made the steady state response also. So this is the steady state response overlap with the transient response, and this is with angular velocity how the transients are coming once we are going away from the resonance condition. Today we have seen one is the steam hold, and how the steam hold can give instability in the system, and how we can able to get the condition of instability, which are the parameter which can govern the, or which can able to stabilize the system in which there is a possibility of the steam hold. So we have seen that if we have more damping in the system, or if more the natural frequency is more of the system, then that means if you have more rigid rotors, we can have the more stable threshold speed. That means we can able to increase the speed of threshold for the steam hold with these two parameter. Apart from this, we have seen how the model of the seals we can have in a simple Jeffcott rotor, and what are the conditions we can get for a rotor with seals. Those expressions were more general in nature, and that can be used for more specific cases or to understand various parameter and the seal parameter. Maybe one by one those parameter can be considered, and we can able to analyze the stability of the system in more detail. Apart from this, we took up a case of the run up or run down of a rotor, which is often is there in the practice to avoid the critical speed, or to traverse the critical speed and the instability zone quickly. We need to give some kind of quick acceleration, angular acceleration to the rotor, and but because of that we can have some kind of non-stationary response. So how the rotor will behave in such cases, we try to understand in the particular case. In this we had the equations are nonlinear, so we use time integration to solve, to get the responses, and that is more practical tools, because when we are dealing with a more complex system, bigger system, then that is the only possibility that we can able to analyze the such bigger system using direct time integration. There are methods, the analytical methods for nonlinear system analysis, so that we have not dealt with in this particular course. So in the subsequent lecture we will see some more cases of the instability, and we will try to see how these can be analyzed more effectively, especially for large system. We will take up some case in which the large system with fluid film bearing instability, how we can able to check.